everything I asked Carrie to help me with, he jumped in wholeheartedly. Whatever needed to take place at the church, the answer was always yes. Sometimes I wouldn't even get the entire question out. I'd say, Harry, I need, and he said, okay. And I said, but I haven't told you yet. He says, well, whatever it is, the answer is yes. And that's the kind of man that he was. Many hearts are broken that they can't be here today, Miss Glenda, and to the family. They want to be here, and they want to support you. But because of this virus, we just can't do it. I want you to please know that your church loves you dearly, and that we're going to be with you in these days to come, these hard days that will follow. I know you're going to miss Harry. It's going to be difficult. It's going to be hard. Expect those times. And you mourn. That's a natural thing to do. And when this virus passes, I promise you, when it's safe to gather together again, we are going to have a memorial service at the church. And I'm inviting all of you to be there for that memorial service. And I promise you, it's going to be done right. According to his obituary, Harry was born on July 23rd, 1945, and he went home to be with Jesus on March the 27th of this year. So the Lord blessed him with 74 years here on planet Earth. And just for me, I think he used his time wisely. He loved his family and he loved his God. And I imagine Harry walking into those pearly gates and God saying, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Harry was born here in Coates, and he recently retired so he could spend more time with the love of his life, Miss Glenda. He talked about you so sweetly. It's a shame we don't tell the people face to face what we tell others privately, but he had so many kind words to say about you. You were the love of his life and his children and his family, his church. In our church, he served as head deacon for a number of years. And he had so many friends that he cherished. A lot of you guys are standing along this line. I tell you, I think it would have meant a lot to Harry to see all of you all pull in here ahead of him today. I think he was honored by that, so thank you for doing that. So many friends that he cherished, and he always had time for them. He was extremely well known and respected in the community, and our community is going to severely miss him. One of the things I loved about Harry in support of the church is he knew everybody. So if I said, hey, what about this family? He said, oh yeah, here's their whole background. So I know about all of you. Be good to the pastor because I know all the secrets, amen. He would stay with me and we would sit sometimes for hours in my office. At least once a week, he would come into my office and he just turned the corner and said, hey, preacher, how you doing? I said, I'm doing great, man. Come on in and sit down. And he'd take a chair there in front of my desk, and we talked for 2 or 3 hours, and I'm not exaggerating. And he told me all about his family, so I know all your family secrets. And I told him all of my about my family and my family secrets, and we were just good buddies. And I'm going to really miss those times. He was an incredible man. But I want to say this. And I hope you keep this in mind today. If you know Christ as your Savior, you're going to see Harry again. This is not the end. We'll see Harry again. He's there in heaven right now, waiting for us with open arms.
Shackled by a heavy burden, neath a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. He touched me, oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something wonderful happened, and now I know he touched me.
since I've met my blessed Savior, since he's cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something wonderful happened, and now I know.
I talked to Dad about this before. He wanted me to put some rap music on today, but I couldn't honor that. But you know, if you knew him, you knew him well, he liked to make people laugh. And he did say he wanted me to try to make it lighthearted. I don't know if I can get through it, but we'll try. But he was a good man, everybody knows that, and knew him. And obviously was very proud to call him my father. Those who knew him, the pastor said, knew that he loved God, he loved his family, he loved people, and he really loved to laugh. And make people laugh. Those that really knew him, also, as the pastor said, knew he could be a little rough at times. He could get a little too irritated, a little too quick sometimes. But under that gruffness, he had a huge heart. Loving, caring, giving. He probably wouldn't want me to tell this, but he'd sit down and watch TV, and if it had anything sad in it, he'd cry like a baby. Unfortunately, I inherited that trait myself. So. But as the pastor said also, he loved God. He was a deacon for many years in his church. He was a Sunday school teacher for many years. Very heavily involved in the church any way he could be to help. He loved his family. He raised two sons. He raised two stepchildren. He raised two step-grandchildren. He didn't have to do it, and he did it. He was our go-to guy for a lot of things. If you needed to know something about cars, motorcycles, insurance, plumbing, electricity, he was always the one to go to and call. He had information. He just knew a lot of things that could give you direction if he couldn't give you the answer. He was married three times, so I never asked him for relationship advice by any means. But he also, I said he loved people. That was evidenced by the fact that besides his church, he was involved in numerous organizations. You probably saw that in his obituary. He was a Shriner, a Mason, involved in a Lions Club, did Civil War reenactments. He rode with two or three different motorcycle groups through the years. And as Glenda said earlier, to the guys over here that came here today and escorted him in, the American Legion really did touch his heart. And he said, y'all, y'all took him in. Like no one else ever had. And he loved riding with you and being with you. But he did all those things just to be with people and to do for people. Some other examples is that he was 20 years old when I was born, and he had to raise me as a single father. And Aunt Louise, and Uncle Bobby, helped him quite a bit. He was young and didn't know what he's doing. They gave him advice, and they really helped take care of me. And Aunt Louise is another one that's had one of the biggest hearts of anybody you ever meet in your life. And he never forgot that. And just by a twist of fate, she ended up living right across the street from him. So every week he cut his grass, he made sure he cut hers and trimmed hers. When his neighbor, Francis Eason, was widowed, every week he cut his grass, he cut and trimmed hers. It's just the things he did for people, because he loved people and he loved to give. He had a very, very giving heart, as I said. He didn't have much, but he gave it all away anyway. I mean, he would, if there was something going on and they wanted him to cook, he would go buy 10 or 15 chickens and a hog or a half a hog or a bunch of shoulders and cook, buy everything that he needed, spend it all, never ask for any money, and then he'd go home for 2 or 3 weeks and stress out on how he's going to pay his bill. But that was Harry. There were a lot of places he wanted to go, a lot of things he wanted to see and do that he never got to do, because he gave it all to us, his family. He would go out and get a really good deal on some chicken or steaks or something like that, and you'd come to visit him, and he'd want to give you some of it because he got such a good deal on it. And I try to tell him, Dad, if you start giving it away, you add up what you paid per pound. After you give some of it away, you didn't get such a good deal after all. He didn't care. He wanted you to take some anyway. He just had a giving heart. It's just what he wanted to do. It made him live. And lastly, I said he loved to laugh. He loved to make people laugh. If you knew him for very long, I guarantee you he's told you at least 10 or 15 jokes, minimum. If you've known him for a while, he's told you 100 plus, I can guarantee you. Except for maybe the preacher, some of them he probably couldn't told him. But since he did so much for others, and some of you that are here today, I'm going to ask you today to please. Do him a favor today and give back to him. I want you all to do two things. I want you to think of a time he made you laugh. And if you can, I want you to remember a joke he told you. And I want you to pass that on to somebody. Pass on a little bit of Harry Denton. Pass this day. I promise you, he'd absolutely love that. It'd mean the world to him.
face the devil. You're no stranger to. So go rest high on that mountain. The sun you work on earth. Go to gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see the angels when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high.
Disconnected.
Folks, we are out in the middle of a cemetery trying to play music, so I'm sorry that they had some skips in there, but I think the message came across by the expressions on all of your face, and so we thank God for that. Brother Jamie, you want to?
I just want to tell y'all, thank you for being here to honor Dad. I just asked my brother, did he sneak in there and read the statement I had written, because it was almost identical. It was actually scary how identical it was. But one thing I can tell you is Daddy loved his family. He loved his friends. And like Kenneth said, there's nothing he wouldn't do for anybody. If he liked you, he liked you, and if he didn't, he didn't. He didn't candy coat it, he didn't sugar coat it. But I will add one thing. For my sisters and brothers and myself and Kenneth as well, Daddy, he did teach us one other thing, and that was this. When life don't go the way you think it's supposed to go, you find another way, and you make it happen. You provide for your family, you take care of your family first, and then you take care of your friends. And other than that, everything else pretty much I had written was almost identical to what Kenneth wrote. So I'm not gonna hold everybody up rereading what Kenneth's already said. I just wanna thank you all for being here. Thank you for showing your love and support. And thank you for honoring my dad.
Thank both of you guys and Miss Angela too for singing. It takes a lot when it's your father, your family, and you get up in front of everybody. I preached my own father's funeral, and it was one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life. But praise the Lord, 46 people got saved at that funeral. And so I know that God wanted me to do that. And I am so sure and confident in my heart today that Harry would want me to preach this sermon today. And I know what he would say. And as I said and I prepared the message, I did not prepare one of sorrow that's full of sorrow, but instead I put together a message that was about hope, because that's what he would want all of you to hear today, a message of hope, not a message of sorrow. Amen. It's just who he was. So I want to assure you that this is not the end of Harry Denton. This is not the end of Harry. And while his body lays in state here and it's broken, his soul and his spirit today are with Jesus in heaven. And folks, many times we hear this called the final resting place. And I want to promise you, for Harry Denton and for Christians, there's nothing final about this place. Because the day is going to come, and yes, I'm getting ready to preach, the day is going to come when Harry's going to come up out of this casket, and he's going to go and meet Jesus in the clouds, and we look forward to that day. And all of us who know Christ will join him, and we'll go off to heaven, and forever we'll be with the Lord. This is not his final resting place. His body's here, but his soul and his spirit live on with Christ in heaven. Right now, he's seeing and experiencing things too great for us to imagine with our feeble minds. He's looking into the face of God. Can you imagine that? He's experiencing the wonder and splendor of heaven. He has a brand new body that's perfect, that's young and healthy. He'll never experience sorrow or hurting again. And I want to encourage you, when you think of Harry in the days to come, think of him in heaven, not here in this place. He's not here. The tomb is empty, just like Jesus. Harry is not here. The Apostle Paul wrote, "Be confident, and I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." And so what this verse is telling us is that when we leave this body, if we know Christ, when we leave this body, immediately our soul and our spirit join with Christ in heaven, and that's where Harry is today. That, folks, that's a promise from God. Harry's in the Lord, in the Lord's arms right now, and God never lies in his word. You know, I didn't find it coincidental that for the first series that I taught at Coates Community, 10 weeks, we focused on heaven. 10 weeks, the first sermon series that we taught was on heaven. And folks, we had a memory verse that went along with that. It was 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9. And it says, but as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. And what this verse teaches is that we've never seen anything so grand as heaven. We've never heard anything so wonderful as what's taking place there. And we can't even, with these minds that we have, even imagine the greatness that Harry's experiencing right now. When Harry drew his last breath in this life, he was carried by the angels to heaven. And he's safe, and he's whole, and he's blessed, and he's waiting there for us. Harry's in heaven because a day came in his life when he heard the truth of God's word and responded. And I feel like if he were standing here, what he would say is, "What about you? Have you had that day?" I think if Harry had the ability to leave heaven today and be here with us, I know what he would say to me. He would say, "Pastor Chuck, I can hear the words in my mind. Pastor Chuck, say is, "Pastor Chuck, please tell my loved ones how they can join me one day in heaven." That's what's in his mind and his heart right now. He would tell me, "Give them the truth of God's word during my funeral." And I think he would have a message for all of you that are here today as well. I think he would turn and he would say to each one of you, "Listen closely. Open your heart and receive the Lord's love and forgiveness that only Jesus can offer." When Jesus was here on this earth, he spoke to his disciples about how a man can spend eternity with God. He gave them promises that apply to us as well. He knew his time on this earth was short, Jesus knew, and that soon he would be leaving this world via the cross. And of course, that troubles his disciples greatly. And here are his words and his promises that he gave them. As the time grew near for him to go to heaven, he said in John chapter 14, verse 1 through 6, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know." But Thomas, was one of his disciples, said, "Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way?" And Jesus gave us one of the most important scriptures in the entirety of the Bible. He said unto them, "I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And no man cometh to the Father but by me." Did you hear that? I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life, and no man cometh to the Father but by me. Jesus is the way. He meant exactly what he said. He said he was the only way. Simply put, Jesus came to make a way for us to be forgiven of our wrongdoings and our sins. And our sins separate us from a holy and righteous God, and we're all guilty. Sin cannot stand in the presence of a holy, righteous God. And sin will be punished because God is righteous and he always does the right thing. The most important message that you ever hear, that you'll ever hear in this life, is what I'm giving you today. It's the most important decision a person can ever make. And this is exactly the message I know with great confidence that Harry would want you to hear. So many times he told me, "Preach this message." In the first couple of months, 29 people came to know Christ, and Harry rejoiced over it because he realized what it means. And there's just five simple things that you need to know in order to become right with God, to be forgiven of everything that you ever have done, ever will do, that's wrong. And you can secure a place for yourself in eternity. And I want to share those five things with you today, and hopefully you'll make a decision for Christ as well. It's what Harry would want. It's certainly what God would want. And this is straight from the Bible. But the first thing that you need to know is that you need to be saved. Everybody here, every one of us, we need to be saved. The Bible teaches in Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And what that means is that everybody that's assembled here today has sinned against God. It means we've done the wrong thing. And we're all guilty. And the Bible says that we sin against God in three ways, with things we think, say, and do. And in the course of a day, I don't think it's hard to imagine that each and every one of us thinks, says, and does one thing that we shouldn't. It's contrary to what God teaches. And when we do what we want rather than what God wants, it's called sin. And it will separate us from God for all of eternity. The second thing is that you cannot save yourself. Many people believe that they're going to go to heaven and stand before God, and there's going to be some type of celestial scale there, and all of their good works are going to be loaded on one side and their evil works on the other side, and if the good outweighs the evil, then you get into heaven. Just one problem, folks, that's not what the Bible teaches. That's not what the Bible says, and we've got to go by the Word of God. So, the Bible teaches in Titus chapter 3 and verse 5, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saves us." You see, we're all sinners, folks, every single one of us. And we think, well, God is big and he's mercy and he's love. He is all of those things, but he's also righteousness and pure and holy. And those attributes will cause him to judge you one day. And it's for certain that each and every one of us will stand before God and give an account for our lives. And I'm encouraging you today to get it right with God, to not leave this place, to make this day count for something extra. Harry would want that. I want you to imagine in your life, if you just say, think, and do one thing you shouldn't each day, that's only three sins. Surely God can forgive you for that. But there's 365 days in a year. So that's over 1,000 sins each year. 1,000 times you broke the law, God's law. And however old you are, I'm 60 years old. So if I only sin three times a day, I broke God's law 60,000 times. Now, if God is righteous, he has to judge me. and he will judge me. And he'll send me to the place called the Lake of Fire for all of eternity. But Jesus stands in the gap. And that's the good news. The third thing that you need to know is that Jesus has provided for your salvation. And the Bible teaches in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Listen to me. Listen to me today. Jesus came and gave his life to pay for your sins and to pay for my sins. He came, he left the glories of heaven and was born of the Virgin Mary. And he walked on this earth for 33 years, was tried, tempted, and tested just like we are, but was never found with sin. And because he was sinless, he was the perfect sacrifice. And so he gave his life. They took him and they mistreated him. They beat him across the back, scourged him. They nailed him to a cross. They put a crown of thorns on his head. And they treated him horribly. Jesus bore all of that for you. They nailed him to the cross. And while he was nailed to the cross, he was thinking of each and every one that's gathered here today because he loves you. And he said, he cried out to God the Father, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." That's love, my friends. And God gave his Son, and Jesus died on that cross, and he paid the price for our sins. See, the Bible teaches that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission or forgiveness of sin. And so it's going to be a blood sacrifice that's required, either the substitutionary blood of Christ, or it's going to be your blood. It's going to be your sins that stand before God. Jesus made a way to go to heaven because the grave could not hold him. They took him down and they put him in a borrowed tomb. And on the third day, he rose again. And he conquered death and hell, so we never have to go there. Harry heard this message and he responded to it. And that's why we can be assured that Harry is in heaven with Jesus today. This is the gospel message, my friends. This is the truth that we all need to hear. The fourth thing that you need to know is that you must accept Jesus for salvation. The Bible teaches in Acts chapter 16 and verse 31, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved." But there's a second part, and that is what to do. "That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And so now at this point, you've heard everything that's necessary. You've heard everything that Harry heard. And now the decision and the choice is yours. And I pray that you today will accept Christ and his forgiveness. Jesus did everything he could. He gave his life so that you could have life. But if you leave this place without knowing Christ, and you're in an accident, my friend, it'll be too late. So make the decision today. You say, "Well, how do I do that, Pastor? How do I get right with my God?" It's very simple. You believe in your heart what I've taught you, that Jesus came and lived and died and shed his blood and rose again for your sake. And then you call upon his name and ask him to save you. And you do that with a prayer of faith. Jesus has done all the work. It's just whether or not we want to accept his forgiveness. And so I would encourage you, in just a minute, I'm going to ask everyone to bow their heads. And if you're here today and you don't know Christ, why would you not get it right? None of us are promised tomorrow. The Bible teaches that our life is like a vapor. It appears for a short time and then it vanishes away. I spoke to Harry on the day that he died. That morning, I called to check on Miss Glenda. He and I and everyone else had no idea that that was his last day. He was not promised another day, and neither are any of us. But do not go out into eternity without getting this right with God. And now's your opportunity. Can I have every head bowed, please, and no one looking around? In just a moment, I'm going to lead you in what we call the sinner's prayer. And in this prayer, you ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins and to come into your life and save you. Harry's done this, and he's in heaven because he did. Now the decision is yours. and I pray that you'll make this decision. I want you to know that you can get saved. You can be forgiven of your sins right where you're standing or sitting today. And it would bring such honor to God. And so I leave it to you. If you're here and you want to make a decision for God, follow me in this prayer. Don't say it out loud. You don't have to say it out loud. You don't have to, and please don't say it to me. But say it from your heart to Jesus. And say this prayer. Say, "Dear God, I confess that I am a sinner. I do believe that Jesus died for me to pay for my sins. And the best I know how, I trust him now and receive him by faith. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. For it's in your name I pray." Now, every head still bowed, nobody looking around. Folks, I really want to rejoice with you today. And I want it to be a testimony to Harry's life. If you said that prayer today, I'm asking you to be man enough or woman enough to identify yourself. I'm going to ask you in just a second, if you said that prayer and you meant it, to slip your hand up. And let me just identify you. We just want to rejoice to you. I promise you, I'm not coming to you. I'm not pointing you out. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way. But if you said that prayer today and you meant it, would you slip your hand up right now and let me acknowledge you, then put it back down. Put your hand up right now. Did you say that prayer? Yes, sir, I see you. Yes, sir, I see you. Are there others? Yes, ma'am, I see you. Yes, sir, I see you. I see you, sir. Are there others? I'm looking. Hold your hand up high so I can see. Are there others? Are there others? Be honest. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. And he won't be ashamed of you when you enter into heaven. If you said that prayer, slip your hand up right now and let me see. As far as I can tell, 5 people came to know Christ today at Harry's funeral. And I want to promise you, Harry's dancing a jig in heaven right now. The Bible teaches us that there's joy in the presence of angels over one sinner that repents. And today, 5 repented. It doesn't say that the angels rejoice. It says the ones that stand in his presence rejoice. And that would be the ones that have gone on before. And I believe with all of my heart that during times like this that God pushes back the clouds and lets people look down. Here he's looking down on us today and he saw those decisions that were made for Christ. And his heart is full of joy for each one of you. And I thank you for your honesty and for your love for Harry and for this family. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I just thank you, God, for your great love for us. And Lord, today we come before you, your throne of mercy and grace, just asking you to bless this sweet family. The coming days are going to be hard. They're going to miss Harry. Lord, he's not going to be there. But Lord, we know where he is. And we know, God, that you got him in your arms and that, Lord, he's safe. But Lord, please watch over this family and bless them, God, and help them during this time of trouble. Give them comfort and peace. Give them the peace that passes all understanding. And God, thank you so much for these 5 souls that raised their hand today to receive Christ. I know Harry is rejoicing with you today in heaven for these decisions. And some of these were family, and I know that how much that means to him. Thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, folks, I want to thank you so much for being here today. And I pray that God will bless you in the coming days. Please keep in mind, we're in the midst of a crisis right now with this coronavirus. And so I've just been asked to remind everyone, please don't shake hands and get real close to folks. It's for everyone's safety, amen. Thank you for being here today, Miss Glenda. We'll be there for you in the coming days. And thank all of you, and just on behalf of Miss Glenda and the family, I just want to thank all of you for taking time out today to come and to honor Harry. I know he's pleased right now. Amen. Thank you so much. You're dismissed. My lady.
Let's go this way, because I'm scared to go down.
Justin.
Well, we didn't do this.
Yeah, it's funny because my friend owned it before they had it. It used to be Norman Cheek that owned it, and I'm friends with his grandson.
Guy lived in
uplifted
from this quarantine.
Yeah.
Let us know. We'll go out to dinner.
Yeah, at least we can do it
there. But of course, now they're talking about shutting our
budget. Yeah.
We'll wait a little while longer. Yeah.
How did Steve do it? How did he fail? Doing the deck, right?
Hey, babe, how are you?
Where's Mr. Dennis?
But if you're thinking,
Mr. Dennis is look right there with the flag, straight ahead, right through there.
I'm going to go see.
Okay. I know I was reading your Facebook.
So he said,
yes, sir. I'll be back.
Dave. Dave.
Yes, sir.
You done good, I know.
So we
got to I sit here and listen to me. I believe it. And the first,
I think what you can hear me.
My stepfather's 82.
The first three quarters of it.
I swear.
I got it. Because all plays I've done.
He enjoys
it. So the only part that I never really.
Yes, sir. He'll be out there 105 degrees mowing grass.
You know, that's dead.
And it's like,
hey, Bob.
He'll wait 2.5 days.
Find a way. Make it work. That's right. He always lived back. But yeah, I appreciate it.
Yeah, I saw that. I was looking at her Facebook. I was reading it, and it's just, he failed. And it didn't give any details. He can't be good. Whatever, it's tough. I broke some before, and oh Lord, have mercy.
But it's back to your hub.
Good. Could just be what do they call it? Not an aneurysm. Hematoma. Hematoma.
Oh goodness.
So it. Yeah. It's a beautiful red motorcycle. Thing is, we'll step into the sun after you cold.
I'm a little chilly. I did not pack for this weather.
I'm going to go ahead and 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 I'm going to go ah I don't know. thank y'all. We won't go in the van, will we? What they gonna pick it up from? Go in it.
I told them a pickup would be a lot more.
I need you.
Him and my brother Cecil, pretty good friends.
My wife, her, 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 her,
Carry two hands, buddy.
What about my phone?
Put it on.
Always listen to the rest.
Put it on with this in my hand.
Let it down. I'll hold the